Random House Audio presents Collaborate or Perish, Reaching Across Boundaries in a Networked World, written and read by William Bratton and Zachary Tumin.
Introduction. We live in a digital age, a networked world, where the race is on to out-collaborate, out-network, and out-innovate adversaries, competitors, and even nature. In today's networked world, virtually everyone is connected. Today, 800 million of your friends are on Facebook. None were there a few years ago. In 5 years, Google's Eric Schmidt says Chinese language web pages will dominate search returns. In 2011, 20 million joined Google Plus's new platform in a matter of weeks. By 2020, 12 billion mobile devices will connect to the internet. The rate of change is heart-stopping. Plan to go it alone? Think again. 50 years ago, the visionary Marshall McLuhan foresaw today's global village where it's impossible for someone in Tunisia to tweet a demonstration without someone in Cairo catching wind of revolution. We live in a boundary age where change is fast, but none of us moves quite as fast as change. Sometimes it seems we want the fast fixes of the digital world to solve slow-moving disasters that have been with us for a long time. Dangle the right incentives in front of teachers, surely student scores will rise, won't they? Add more cops, surely crime will fall. Layer more regulation on food growers, surely our dinner tables will be safer. What, no app for that? If only. Even in a networked world, schools stay broken, financial systems stay stacked. Tails I win for rich guys and heads you lose for Main Street. Poor people die hungry and broken from New York to Rio to Mogadishu. Being connected is no silver bullet, not when the move forward runs into go-it-alone, no-one-does-it-better mindsets. Those are powerful headwinds few can take on alone. In the network world, no one needs to. Where everyone is connected, the game-changer is collaboration. Reaching across boundaries, often abetted by technology that connects us all, collaboration unleashes the power of the many to do together what none can do alone. Collaboration is about people. If it were only about technology, the one with the best toys would always win. Technology can tip change and speed it up. But in the networked world with change moving fast, success depends more than ever on having the right people saying yes and doing yes. That takes a new mindset, one that says we can achieve more together than we can alone. A mindset that looks across boundaries of departments, companies, and nations and sees people as partners and change as opportunity, not threats. A mindset for collaboration. Collaboration lets you start with a simple plan to bring two schools onto a network and within 3 years, scale to 20,000, as Doug Hull did in Canada. Collaboration lets you find the one farm in a million that's shipping tainted produce around the nation, not in months or days, but in hours, as the FDA's David Acheson and industry partners did. When the U.S. Navy lost its undersea advantage to espionage, Bill Johnson regained it not in 5 years, as admirals predicted, but in 18 months, by collaborating with vendors and researchers on new submarine sonar that used commercially available off-the-shelf systems. The police officers and citizens of New York and Los Angeles restored their cities after years of crime and disorder with one strategy, collaboration. Steve Ellis moved Wells Fargo's commercial customers to the internet and brought astounding returns to the bank by collaborating. 80% of things we built, the ideas are our customers. 20% are ours, Ellis said. Paul O'Neill led Alcoa to record profits by rallying all Alcoans around a single vision. Make it the safest workplace in the world. Collaborating, workers and executives perfected Alcoa's business processes and took its financial performance through the roof. Claudia Costin, Rio de Janeiro's Secretary of Education, mobilized Rio's teachers, students, and business leaders to restore the city's schools, return the joy to teaching, and give Rio's desperately poor public school children something many thought impossible, an education. She started the collaboration on Twitter. In the Arab Spring of 2011, millions of Egyptians led themselves through city streets and squares energized by one shared vision, The people want to overthrow the regime. Are you ready to collaborate? Even if you think you are, it's not just about you. It's about the people, the technology, the platforms, the politics. Everything you need to win, whatever contest you're in, whether it's for health and prosperity, fun and games, or safety and security. In Collaborator Parish, we created 8 tests of readiness you should know before you start. Number 1, have a vision. A vision of a better day and a better way energizes people around you. It conjures up a world others want to work toward and support. It captures their imaginations and their passion. Number 2, right-size the way forward. Make it doable. Deliver value fast. Not all of it, but enough to prove to all, we know how to do this. Number 3, create a platform, a physical or virtual clearing that collaborators can find, get to, trust, and use. That's where you share knowledge, insight, and assets, and take steps together. Number 4, make it pay. Collaboration requires there be something in it for everyone, whether it's glory and honor, money and power, latitude and position, or a chance to do the job they showed up to do. Whatever the currency, collaboration needs to pay for those who will be with you on the journey. Number 5, have the right people with you. From top performers to sponsors backing you and giving you cover, to everyday folks eager for change, waiting for your signal, and a sense of the path they should follow. Number 6, deliver on performance. Collaboration can promise a way better, faster, or cheaper, or more efficient, equitable, or effective. Whatever the promise, that's the performance collaboration must deliver. Number 7, mind your political support, stay in its headlamps, and ensure that you have what you need to deliver on the promise. Number 8, you must have the passion and the playbook to lead, whether from above, the middle, the side, or below. Leadership in a collaboration helps make it pay for everyone. You help everyone achieve together what none can accomplish alone. As you'll discover in story after story, Collaborator Parish is nothing less than a playbook for collaboration. It offers strategies that alter the go-it-alone habit, move the mindset, and ultimately change the culture. You will see ordinary and extraordinary men and women just like you in action as they work to shape our world together. Chapter 1, The Case for Collaboration. The Hunt for 10 Red Balloons. On October 29, 2009, the Defense Advanced Research Projects Agency, DARPA, announced its network challenge. At 10 a.m. on December 5, 2009, at 10 locations throughout the United States, DARPA would let fly an 8-foot diameter red weather balloon tethered to the ground. Each balloon would be readily visible from local roads and buildings, points the average person could reach. A $40,000 prize would go to the first team to accurately report the location of all 10 weather balloons. The contest was meant to replicate the challenge of trying to gather information about an adversary in an open environment. DARPA wanted to test whether ordinary folks, using commonly available off-the-shelf technology and social media like Twitter or Facebook, could work together, collaborate, to solve a problem that would be, in the words of one expert from the National Geospatial Intelligence Agency, impossible to solve by traditional intelligence-gathering methods. A team from MIT's Media Lab won. No surprise there. MIT had a slew of faculty and top graduate students, the most sophisticated equipment, and great publicity. CNN profiled them and drew attention to their cause. A Georgia Tech team placed second, for similar reasons. Both teams competed fiercely. They put out misinformation, reported false sightings, sent others on wild goose chases, and bought time for themselves. Both teams wrote complex computer programs to defend themselves against such attacks. Given their advantages, you would expect MIT and Georgia Tech to come out ahead, and they did, with a winning time under 9 hours. But what is interesting is the guy who finished in a tie for third with 8 balloons and actually led the pack for the first 4 hours of the competition, 19-year-old hacker George Hotz. Hotz heard about the contest only a couple of days before, and only an hour before it started, he put up a website called DudeIt'sABalloon.com. How did he do it? His idea was based on a kind of mass collaboration.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.